Okay, so welcome back. So just before the quiz, we were looking at restricted Boltzmann machines, and we started with the motivation of a undirected graphical model, and specifically we introduced the concept of a latent variable and said that all the visible variables, instead of directly depending on each other, actually depend on each other through the latent variables. So this is the neural network that, this is the graphical model that we had, which you see on the left hand side. And you have the visible variables and the hidden variables, and for this discussion we had assumed that all of these are binary. And what were the factors in this graphical model? What were the factors? Edges between the visible variables and the hidden variables, right? So you had these, how many factors did you have? M cross n factors. And what was the parametric form that we chose for the factors? We said that each factor depends on the corresponding visible and hidden variable between which the factor is, and there is a weight associated with that, right? So that is what we decided. Vi, Hj, those are the visible and hidden variables in the pair, and Wij was the weight associated with that. And in addition, we also had factors for the visible variables and the hidden variables. And we said all of this is legal as long as we compute the partition function so that the entire thing gets normalized as a distribution, okay. So if I pick one, visible variable, how many terms in this summation correspond to that? Remember, this is a double summation. My question is, if I pick one visible variable, how many terms in this summation correspond to that? Assume there are n visible variables and m hidden variables. My question is, if I take one of these guys, m of those, and what about this? How many some terms in this summation correspond to 1, and about this? 1. So just remember this, we will need this for deriving certain things here. So there are m terms here corresponding to each visible variable that we have. Is that fine? And I think, this is m and this is n. Just the confusion that I needed at the beginning of the lecture. So there are m visible variables and n hidden variables. So that means if I repeat my question, how many terms in the summation correspond to this? N. Okay. Fine. So now with that background, what we wanted to do is justify that why we are teaching this in a course on deep learning. So we have to show that RBMs have some connection to neural networks, and that's what we'll see in this module, which is we'll try to see RBMs as stochastic neural networks, okay. So what we will do is, given all this definitions and notations that we have, and in particular this energy function that we have, we will start to derive the formula for P of V given H and P of H given V. Can I do that? Why can I do that? Because once I have the joint distribution, I can compute all kinds of conditionals and marginals involving those random variables, right. So let us look at one of the unit, one of the visible variables, okay. Let us look at one of the visible variables, and I am interested in getting a formula for that visible variable taking on the value 1, right. That is what I am interested in, okay. Now what I will define is, I will define a term known as V subscript minus L, which is essentially to denote the state of all the variables except this lth variable. So when I say V minus L, it means all the other visible variables except this variable. Is that clear? Okay, the set of all the visible variables except the one which I am interested in. And I will define two quantities. The first one is alpha, which corresponds to the lth unit. What does alpha actually capture? It is relevant to the question which I had asked you just now. It is in that, in this formula, what does alpha L actually capture? All the terms corresponding to the lth unit, okay, that is what it captures. Is that clear? How many of you get that? Please raise your hands, okay. Now what does beta capture? Focus on this. Actually, if you look at these two equations look exactly the same, except that I have removed the terms from the summation which correspond to the lth term, okay. Now in terms of alpha and beta, can you give me a formula for E? E of V comma H is equal to something which involves alpha and beta. Alpha plus beta, is that correct? you're saying alpha plus beta. Alpha VL plus beta. How many of you agree with this? Okay, that's straightforward to see. So that's what E of V comma H is, right? It's VL times alpha plus beta, right? And I've just written this particular, broken it down this way so that later on when we are deriving something, it would be easy to cancel out some terms and so on, right? So with this definition, now let's try to compute a formula for V of L equal to 1 given H. And why don't I have V comma H here? Given, I should have put this in the syllabus actually, and not asked, but at least put this in the syllabus so that you could have learned it. Is that fine? Because the V's are independent given the H, right? That's as simple as that. Okay, so I can always introduce these variables here. It doesn't matter. Is that fine? Because these two are equivalent. Now, I can write it as this. Okay. Which, okay, first tell me about the denominator. I know P of V comma H, I know P of V comma H. How do I get P of V minus L comma H? I'll have to, how many elements does this have? How many random variables does this have? M plus N. How many random variables does this have? M minus 1 plus N. So now what do I have to do? I have to do an operation which starts with an M and ends with a Z E. Marginalize over Lth unit. That means I have to sum over all possible values of the Lth unit. Is that fine? Okay. And that's exactly what the denominator is. Don't focus on the numerator, just focus on the denominator. Right? I have taken both the values of VL and computed the probability and just summed over that. Is that fine? The denominator is just marginalizing over the Lth unit of interest. How many of you get that? Okay. Now, how many of you get the numerator? That's simple, right? The numerator has all the m plus n variables, and in particular, I know the value of one of these variables. So, I'll just plug that into the energy function. Is that fine? Right? So, remember the energy function has these vi's and hj's, right? So, I know the value of Vi, so I am just going to plug in that particular value, or rather VL. Is that fine? Okay. Now, based on this alpha beta business that we just did, I am going to just rewrite some of these things. Remember, E was alpha into VL plus beta. Okay. So, is the numerator clear? Let's focus on the numerator first. I know that VL is equal to 1, so I have just substituted 1 there. And beta I have written as it is. How many of you get the numerator? Please raise your hands. Okay. And the denominator is again something very similar. Alpha plus beta. I know the alpha value of VL is 1 in this case and the VL is 0 in this case. Is that fine? Now what do I do next? What is common factor here? E power minus beta factor is common, right? Okay. Okay, and this of course, since it's 0, it will just be e raised to 0, which is 1. So, just the beta part remains here. Now, if I take the e raised to minus beta factor common, what will I get? Have you ever seen this formula ever in your life? Sigmoid of? And what was alpha LH? Minus of this quantity, right? Is that fine? So, the probability of the Lth unit being 1 is actually the sigmoid of a weighted sum of all the incoming connections. Does that statement make sense? How many of you get what I just said? The probability of the Lth unit being 1 is actually the sigmoid of the weighted sum of all the inputs connected to it. And what are the inputs connected to the visible unit? All the hidden units, right? So it's a weighted sum of that. So I can write it as this. Similarly, if I were to compute the probability of the Lth hidden unit taking on the value 1, by the same kind of derivation, I will get this form, right? That it's again a sigmoid of the weighted sum of all the inputs connected to it. And what are the inputs connected to it? All the visible units. Is that fine? Okay. And now can you tell me why did we have these additional factors? The biases. Okay. So now can you think of this as a neural network? Right? We have got the same form as we have seen for a neural network. It can be interpreted as a stochastic neural network, which tells us what's the probability of the hidden unit firing given a certain set of inputs, or alternately, we were interested in both, right? Abstraction and generation. So when I'm doing abstraction, what am I interested in? Computing what given what? Everyone? Hidden given the observed variables. And when I'm talking about generation, what am I interested in? Computing visible units given the hidden variables, right? So in both of these things, I can think of it as finding out what's the probability of the hidden unit being on given a particular configuration of the visible units, and alternately, what's the probability of the visible unit being on given a particular configuration of the hidden units. Is that fine? So both of these can be interpreted as a stochastic neural network where I'm getting certain probabilities from a computation which looks very much like a neural network computation. Okay? Okay. So given this neural network interpretation of RBM, and given the answer which I've already given you, what does H actually compute? Your ability to disappoint it, a dash representation. I thought I'll have to say starts with an A, ends with a T. Okay. It is learning an abstract representation of V. So this is very similar to what? What kind of a neural network? Autoencoder. Why did you say autoencoder? We do the same in multi-layer perceptron also, right? We are given an input, we have multiple layers, and then we compute, every layer computes some hidden representation of the input. What was the difference between the training data for an autoencoder and a multilayer perceptron? Unsupervised. In the case of multilayered perceptron, we had x, y. Our objective function was some squared error loss defined on y, or some cross entropy loss defined on y. Right? That was supervised learning. We were learning task specific abstract representations. In the case of autoencoders, what was our training data? Just x. Right, just the visible variables, no hidden variables of course, and no y's also. In the case of RBMs, what's our training data? Same as what we have in autoencoders, just the visible units, we don't have labels associated with them, and of course hidden variables are always out of the question, right? Even those are our imagination, no one is going to give us that, right? So hence we are comparing this to an autoencoder. Now what should be the objective function? Now I've brought it down to a neural network. Once you bring it out to a neural network, what's our favorite learning algorithm? Okay, back, propagation, okay, fine. So that's what our favorite algorithm is going to be. So data I told you, model is RBMs, parameters are obvious, learning algorithm is defined. What's remaining? What should be the objective function? Next lecture means next module. So all that we'll see it soon, we'll see it soon, we'll see it soon, all that will now, that today is soon. So what's the objective function? You want to maximize something. What do you want to maximize? Profits, is it? What has the past few lectures been about? Linear algebra or maximize the KL divergence? Okay. You'll get it before I tell you. Maximize something. What can I maximize? Someone said? Likelihood. Okay.